He is the Executive Vice President for the Kentucky Council on Post-Secondary Education and has more than 25 years of leadership experience in higher education and business. Today, he answered the question, "What would Dr. King say now?" during the annual Martin Luther King Jr. Community Breakfast in Hazard. Dr. Aaron Thompson is our guest tonight on Issues and Answers, The Mountain Edition.
Issues and Answers, The Mountain Edition is sponsored by the City of Hazard. Come home to the mountains.
Check out this week's University of Pikeville Top 5 Plays of the Week. Visit WYMT.com and vote for your favorite, then watch Mountain News at 6 Thursday night to see the winner.
If you have questions about overtime violations or the wage and hour laws in our state, visit ForThePeople.com to learn more. Morgan & Morgan, For the People.
Kentucky Lottery, fueling imaginations, funding education through scholarships in Perry County.
Dr. Aaron Thompson with us tonight. Dr. Thompson, thanks for coming down today.
Thanks for the invitation, Steve.
On this wintry and cold January morning here in eastern Kentucky. You know about the winter and cold here in eastern Kentucky because you grew up here. Just tell me a little bit about your background.
Absolutely. My mother and father, believe it or not, met in Rowdy Holler, I guess close to Sassafras here
really?
In Perry County.
Okay.
My father was a coal miner, and my mother moved here with her father and mother from Alabama, northern Alabama, to the coal mining region. And they met after 3 days, got married, and that was married until he passed in the late 70s. And after their third child, they moved back to Clay County, and that's where I was born.
Okay. Well, tell me a little bit about your experience growing up in Clay County.
Yeah, you know, it was, I'm so old now, Steve, I just had a birthday, so it takes me back to remember. But, you know, I was born in a little log cabin. My mother and father and all of my siblings, I was the youngest of nine, and paraplegic uncle lived in this small cabin, one dirt floor on one of the floors, and we were sharecroppers, and my father was a coal miner. We were a close family, needless to say. And of course, I grew up during the time when we were segregated schools. Mm-hmm. We were, I think, poor is an understatement. We didn't have very much. We had love and we had subsistence. But I grew up in that way and one of the first kids to be integrated into the wider public school system back in the mid 60s. And went on, obviously, to the Clay County schools and then off to college.
When you were segregated, what kind of schools did you have? Was it like one-room schoolhouse? That type of thing?
We were a little more advanced than that. We had three classroom schoolhouse, went K through 8. You know, we had at least two outside bathrooms. But yes, it was. It was a small schoolhouse, and in those days, they called it Manchester B School, B for black. Mm. So that was a school that I went to, and when we were integrated into the school system, I was in the fourth grade, and it seemed just huge by relative comparison to what I had been used to from kindergarten through the fourth grade.
What do you remember about that time of when you were integrated? Was that difficult? I mean, was there a lot of racism? What kind of things did you experience during that time?
Difficult is really a good way of describing it. It was scary to a degree. I mean, I was integrated and started going to school with kids that had never obviously experienced a person of color before. Mm-hmm. And so much of who they were and what they thought about you were based on stereotypes or ideas or some sense of who they thought they needed to be around you. And it was at times very violent. I mean, I got beaten up several times during the process, name called. Very derogatory names called on a regular basis. And It was during a time whereby there were a lot of things going on, obviously, in the South and in our nation. And so much of some of the things I experienced was based on what people had an interpretation about that was going on nationally and mm-hmm. in the South. So it was a tough time. I remember going home to my father. And once again, I was integrated after the third grade, so I was in fourth grade. And I went home and told my dad, and you have to understand, most people that I knew had quit school or were not going to school. So it wasn't strange at the idea of quitting school. I remember telling my father, Dad, I'm getting beaten up every day and more than one person's picking on me. I get off the bus and they would run me home. And I said, I'm ready to quit school. And my father, who was an illiterate coal miner, wrote his name with an X, said, son, there's two things worth fighting for. One's your family, and two is education. Now, literally, he didn't mean to go back and use my fist. He meant to go back and be persistent and not let people take that away from you. Mm-hmm. And so that was, even though it was tough, it also taught me a lot of resilience and the value of education and what it was worth to put forth whatever effort I need to. And every once in a while it was fist, I won't lie, even though it was only when I had to respond. But it was as much about learning about what I was and who I was and the character as anything else.
Were you the first college graduate in your family?
I was. I was the first. I had a cousin that had graduated from college before me, but in my immediate family, I was the first college graduate. I was first generation high school.
Yeah.
So my mother had an eighth grade education, but okay. I was the first college graduate, and obviously later on, first graduate degree person, and then another graduate degree, and so on. So yeah, I was the first in many long lines of educational attainment.
And your parents lived long enough to see that?
Yeah, they did. My father lived long enough to see me graduate from college. Mm-hmm. I graduated from college in December, and he died in July of the next year. He didn't get a chance to come to the graduation, but my mother did. But my mother lived long enough to see me get multiple graduate degrees, my PhD, and so on. And she was, because she always argued, she said, boy, if you get an education, you'll learn how to count your money. And if you learn how to count your money, you can, she didn't use this word, but she meant this, you can gain wealth. But if you don't have education, you're always having to answer to someone else. And so her idea of getting an education meant that you would have an opportunity to have economic prosperity. My father's idea of education was you get an education, and what he said, you wouldn't have to break your back in the coal mines. I interpreted that as you get an education and you would have options. Mm-hmm. What he really meant, you wouldn't have to break your back in the coal mines. He worked in the coal mines from age 10 to age 60, and back was broken in the coal mines. So he really felt that education was the key to move beyond where he was at.
Your topic today at the breakfast was, what would Dr. King say now? Can you kind of give me a summary of what you spoke about this morning?
Sure. I broke it down in two different ways of looking at it. I talked about it from the standpoint of my life, where I came from, where I am now, and what he would argue that I needed to do with what I've attained. And I talked about that a lot and talked about the four pillars of success, the family, and looking at all aspects of family as the primary producer of success, I would argue. And then from the community, how we need to be coming together as a community from all aspects, whether it's churches, whether it's banks, business, whether it's the peers. I mean, how we grow this youth community, and that important aspect of success. From the institutions, what are we doing to ensure that we have the best educational institutions, to kind of produce that level of success in our kids. And the last one of my personal life was talking about me, or what I call the person. The idea of growing that person to such a degree where that person can recognize when he or she don't have what it takes to be successful. And then number two, how to go about finding that success. Not waiting for someone to give it to him. The idea that if you give them a fish, they'll eat one time. If you teach them how to fish, they'll eat a lifetime. So I gave that as one piece of a conversation with the audience and challenging them to think about their lives and what they need to do to strengthen those four pillars, themselves as well as the community, educational institutions, as well as family. Mm-hmm. Then I talked about Dr. King's legacy. What did he say in 63 with I Have a Dream speech? And what would he say about the things that are going on right now? What would he challenge us to think about with those elements of what's happening now? And showing the distinction as well as a correlation. Celebrating our successes, we've had great success. I grew up, my father was an illiterate coal miner that couldn't go to school. And now, you know, I'm the position I hold in higher education in the state. So we've had great successes. And I'm just one example of that. But we also are fighting some of the very similar sorts of items in our society that Dr. King saw in 1963.
Mm-hmm. I'm just curious, do you have a favorite Martin Luther King speech or quote?
Oh, wow. Mm-hmm. You know, there's so many, and I'm almost afraid to tell you my favorite because I'm going to be stuck on it. I will say that I Have a Dream speech really covered the wide territory. You know, the letter from Birmingham jail called us out a little bit, right? I mean, the way that Dr. King kind of posed his letters to President Johnson to say that, you know, President Johnson, if you don't do something about this, I can't hold back the masses. Mm-hmm. You know, his call to nonviolence was a great call, you know, while at the same time there were other people around him that were tired. So Dr. King, in his speeches and you know, his letters to the president, was saying, you know, the masses are tired. If we don't respond to them, we're going to have other people, whether it's Stokely Carmichael's or Malcolm X or other people that want to see violence explode as a way to show that if you're not willing to give it to us nonviolently, we've got to take it because we no longer can live this way. So that call out, I think, was a good call out that really helped President Johnson to bring about some of the massive changes that people like me experienced in their lives, mm-hmm. right? Whether it was schools or, you know, the civil rights movement. I mean, civil rights legislation, voting rights, and a variety of other areas.
I've always been struck by the last speech he gave the night before he was killed, almost foreshadowing his death.
Oh, yeah. Isn't that eerie?
Yeah.
When you think about it, I mean, it was almost like he had a premonition that he was told that, you know, it's time now to move on. You've done your duty, right? But it was an eerie speech. You know, if you really pay attention to all of his speeches and do it in sequence, it almost tells a story. I mean, it tells a story of a movement that in many ways took place.
Do you think his legacy is much better now because he was struck down in the prime of his life, similar to President Kennedy?
You know, it's... that's a very good question. No one's ever asked me that, and I thought I've had about every question asked of me, and I'm going to be careful how I answer it, but I am going to answer it. I think at 39, being struck down gave us an opportunity to put him in a legacy, gave us an opportunity to offer a way to think about the great things he had done. And to some degree, I would argue that just like basketball players who play too long, you know, their legs get old, and if they play too long, they may lose some of the things that made them great. And so you don't want that to happen. So one part of me is saying yes, because he was struck down while he still had good legs, I call it, mm-hmm. that it gives us an opportunity to really celebrate what he was saying and listen to those anew all the time. Another one would say, wouldn't it have been great to have him another 20 years to kind of get us through some of the stuff? Because we got lazy in the 70s and 80s, I think. We forgot the legacy. Wouldn't it have been great to have Dr. King there as a reminder? So that's the other item. But I would argue that since he was cut down in the prime of his life and at the height of what I would argue to be a civil rights movement success, then I would say that that is the case.
Let's talk about some of the issues we're seeing today. You know, I think many people hope having an African-American president would help unify the country. But it seems to me and a lot of people that we seem to be a little more divided than we have in a while. Do you agree with that? And if so, why do you think that is?
I think we are a little more divided, and that's sad. I'm surely not going to blame the president on that division. What I think is that too many of us of different backgrounds thought that since we ended up electing an African-American president, we lived in a post-racial society. Well, that came to a realization that's not the case because our infrastructures didn't keep up with that. we had a lot of young people who put President Barack Obama in office. They are the people that actually are coming out of a very integrated society. That group of folk that went out in mass and voted were people that had never, very few of them experienced segregation or even thought of race in the same way that we think of race. So that's a wonderful legacy. So I would argue that that group really kind of, they are operating in that sense of the word. Many of us older folk still find ourselves feeling more comfortable in partisan politics and rancor and looking to blame someone and blaming our economic downfalls on someone. And I think just so happens that in a society where we do have an African-American, it's always easy to blame the president, no matter what the color is, mm-hmm. for every bad things that happen, right?
Right.
And I think that in our case, that can really turn into what looks like racism if you're not careful. So that, I think, has created, because he is an African-American president, a conversation that causes people to want to take sides on a variety of issues, race being one of them, and then connect it with some political ideology, which is very problematic to me. So I clearly think under his presidency, we've seen that we don't live in a post-racial society.
Do you think, obviously the president is not very popular here in Eastern Kentucky.
He's not, no.
Do you think that's his ideology? Do you think it's racism or a mixture of both?
Well, I think it's a little mixture of both. I think that it's easy to say that it is racism. Racism carries with it a very interesting process. Then you got explicit racism, you got implicit racism. Mm-hmm. And most of what we have is implicit. So I would argue there is a lot of implicit racism that's going on, whether we don't like to argue that that's what we are, but we are. And sometimes it crosses even people of color. I mean, it doesn't mean that it lies strictly in the hearts of white Americans. Explicitly, I think it's because of some policies. I think explicitly it's easy to connect his environmental policy with the destruction of coal jobs. I think that that is very much a motive. I mean, because I think people in this area want to work. I know I would. And I think that has been a lot of the work in recent as well as past history. So it's easy to look at his policies as very much at least the initial motivation of not liking the president.
Yeah. What do you think about this Black Lives Matter movement across the country?
You know, I think of it in several ways. It's not an easy question for me to answer in a either or. I think the Black Lives Matter movement has a heart that's good. In other words, I think the idea that we have so many African Americans that are losing their lives in so many ways, and not just with police, you know, conflict, but also within the African American communities themselves, blacks killing blacks, you know, drugs overtaking the community in many ways, you know, health issues, and so on. So In the positive element of Black Lives Matter is that I think it calls us out, even black Americans, in saying that we've got to do something about this, because if not, we're, especially our young black men, we're losing them at too rapid of a rate. So it's called out to say that we've got to do that. On the other case, I think it has taken on another life of its own in making a statement that some people argue, well, all lives matter. Well, all lives do matter. Without a doubt, all lives matter. So does it mean that we need to be calling it out just that black lives matter? Well, it depends on where you're at in the process. There is an exaggerated element of deaths among African Americans. So in that case, then I think it's very acceptable. In the case that it's been stated and that it's in conflict with all other lives, I find it problematic. And I think two things in this area. I think the people who started Black Lives Matter or that's keeping it up could have done probably a better job in expressing exactly what they're really meaning by that. Number two, the people who wanted to fight against that as a way of stating some ideology, I think is very problematic for me also. Mm-hmm. So maybe not a good answer to your question, but that's at least the way I think about it.
You know, after that terrible shooting last year, at the church, there was this talk of taking Confederate flags down everywhere. Here in Kentucky, there was a call to take down the Jefferson Davis statue at the Capitol. How'd you feel about that?
Well, first of all, the Confederate flag for me has a very negative connotation because I grew up having the Confederate flag in such a way that it represented a lot of racism to me. Now, do I think it represents racism to everybody? No, I don't. So do I think that people can actually have the Confederate flag who's not carrying the banner of racism? Yeah, absolutely. Do I think that they need to listen how it affects other people who see it? I do. So it's more than just legacy. It's more than just heritage. When I ask people, when people tell me about their heritage, I first of all look to see what kind of Confederate flag they're carrying, whether it's the battle flag or another flag. Then I would ask them to tell me about your heritage. Tell me the richness that you want to express, right? Because what we know is that most of Eastern Kentucky during the war was more Union than Confederate. I mean, in Kentucky, it turned more South after the war was over. So the Confederate flag to me isn't a good symbol for me. It invokes a lot of, but the N-word is not a good symbol for me, no matter even if black people are saying it. I mean, that to me carries at equal the amount of racism in it, right?
Right.
Because I grew up with that, and both of those represented a strong sense of insecurity for me.
Well, what do you think when you hear the N-word in all these rap songs?
I think it's terrible. I was talking to my son about it yesterday. Don't like it. Yeah. I don't like it because I don't think, no matter, and there are people who's going to disagree with this with me all over the place, and I understand that, and I give that to them. That's their belief. I'm talking about me. To me, I don't think you can incorporate or take in nomenclature those items that disenfranchised you so much and not believe that they still disenfranchise you. You don't incorporate that language and make it a part of who you are. I think if it's bad, you reject it and then incorporate something that's good in your life. So although there's different feelings on this all over the place, I think if rap songs disregard or denigrate, or any song disregards or denigrate, no matter who that person is, what color, what gender, or whatever the case may be, I'm a person that's been pushing for equity all of his life. I'm a person that pushed for less disenfranchisement, you know, more resilience, more getting people to a level of success. I can't argue that that's a good word for me, no matter how it's used.
You know, a guy that's been in the news a lot lately, Bill Cosby.
Mm-hmm.
I grew up watching The Cosby Show, loved The Cosby Show.
So did I. My kids still watch it.
What do you think about what's happened to him?
Oh, it's heartbreaking. Yeah. I can't think of a better word. You're talking about an icon. Mm-hmm. As someone that, I mean, because we all do need role models and icons, no matter what, right? I mean, when you think about the 80s and Cosby and even back in the 60s on I Spy, I'm 59 years old. I mean, Cosby was one of those folks that was iconic to us because it represented what could be,
yeah.
Right? You know, and I mean, his preaching on education, he's Dr. William H. Cosby, Jr., mm-hmm. Right? Yeah. I mean, even that in itself, so seeing this, seeing that his transgressions and that his weakness, and clearly if all of these things are true, definite debilitating weakness, could destroy that iconic person and all the things he represented to so many people, not just black people, but people all over, is very sad to me.
Yeah. Let's move on to a few education questions. I'm curious to think, if you think it's easier now than it was maybe 10 or 15 years ago for African Americans to go to college in Kentucky, considering tuition keeps going up.
Oh, I do think it's easier. I think it's easier from the standpoint of the quantitative outputs. I think there are ways that you can make it affordable, and there are ways that we can talk about it being affordable. Mm-hmm. It's harder in the sense of the word that there are, you know, the way we judge entrance in colleges, when you have such gaps coming out of high schools between the two, it's harder in that sense of the word. It's harder to put things in place in, within our universities and colleges to help them to be successful while they're in college. And in some cases, it's harder for, when I was going to college, you know, I worked at night and went to school. You know, I really wanted that degree because I knew it would make my life better. I think we haven't done a very good job, not just with African-American kids, but many of our kids in Eastern Kentucky who aren't African-American, that talks about what is the true value of education. I mean, how can we make it an item that people see the value way beyond just the monetary value, but the health value, the, you know, all kinds of different things, what's good for the legacy of our children value. So I think it's harder that I think we've lost some good sense of what the value of education is.
So how do we get more kids and even adults thinking about higher education and that degree?
Good question. I think there are several things, because we right now have, you know, almost a million adults with some college with no degree, that if we could somehow get back in and get a degree, that could actually add to the workforce. First of all, I think it's I think higher education is truly the key to good economic development. I think higher education is truly the key to good health outcomes. I think higher education is a true key, good education to keeping people out of prisons. So all the money it takes for us to support our, you know, criminal justice system, our healthcare system, and a variety of other things that good education could actually solve is truly very problematic to me. I think we have to convince not only our political infrastructure, the people who are involved in it, but also our mothers and fathers and other people in the community to talk about that, in fact, if we can get you going, then there are jobs. And when I say higher education, I'm not just talking about whether you get a four-year degree. I'm talking about workplace certificates. I'm talking about ways to get people into the employable world. And we also know this, that if we can get people to understand, the adults and traditional students, that the more education you get, then a greater chance we're going to get those employers who want to come to the state. Mm-hmm. To be a part of it. But it is, I think we have to do more than just the marketing ploy. I think that's part of it. I think we really have to start talking everybody, folk in the media, as well as us, on a consistent basis about what is the true value of education for Kentucky. And I think if we do that, and if we all get on the same page, then I think there's a greater opportunity that they will buy into it.
Only have about a minute left. I wanted to ask you about this bill in the legislature to freeze Kentucky college tuition for about 4 years. What do you think about that?
Well, I think we have to really understand what that will do. So many of our, I mean, Bob King and I've been in office 6 months after Bob got there. We've actually kind of mitigated tuition rates to about an average of 4.5%. And what that means is that so much of that money goes to things like scholarships. So much of that money goes to other pieces that if you don't have inflation control, if you freeze it, I think you have to understand what will that do to the universities and colleges themselves. While at the same time, I think we do have to have a conversation about how to make college and universities more affordable. I do worry about affordability, even though right now we can show some elasticity that students can still pay for, because so many of our students with federal dollars and